I mean, that is a good point.
I think we might start seeing some go back. Week 4, 4A style. Hello, everybody. It's Bennett and Grant Goodwin here. Sideline to Sideline, the 4A edition brought to you by SI Design and Printing right here on S2S Sports, part of L4 Media. That's right. Next week, we'll be at the proverbial halfway point of the regular season. Technically, even though there's 11 weeks, everybody still looks at week 5. Week 3 was a weird one. A lot of games out in Northeast Texas through the North Texas area kind of got cut off or completely stopped. Or like Stephenville and Decatur, they decided to have a sleepover, order some pizza, watch some movies, and continue the game later on.
It's almost like a lock-in.
Yeah,
really. Ended at 1:15.
I have not heard the term lock-in in so many years. Lock-in
at the Baptist or Methodist church, right?
You kind of wonder now what they were doing now with some of the reports that come out. I mean, I'm just saying.
There was a long lock-in in the locker rooms, right? Wouldn't you think?
Yeah, you know,
who would want to stay in those smelly locker rooms that are just so cramped?
Yeah, like the joke you and I talk about.
They set outside some.
What do you do? I mean, you know, talking to Ponder's coach, you know, they had the thing where they stopped on Friday and came back on Saturday. And he basically said, you know, we had them up early, had them back. We had them have a breakfast. We watched game film. I mean, that's kind of weird, you know, being able to watch the game film and completely, you could come out with almost a completely new keys and everything. Yeah. But like when you're at the game, like the Stephenville Decatur, where, you know, there was like 2 hours basically of not playing, and then you just have to get up and play. Well, I have opinions about that, so we'll talk about that.
I don't know if I would even. It's not a district game. I would kind of just call it, but I don't know.
Yeah, you know, for that's tough.
A tough call.
Well, it's a good point you bring up, because again, going back to Ponder, because that's who I directly dealt with. They had their first game. Valley View dropped them their first week of the season,
so they needed that.
Chuck Canover, the head coach of Crum, and just was like, hey, look, if we could continue. And he said, you know, Canover was perfectly fine. Ponder said, you know, if he'd have said no, he goes, I would have understood totally. Obviously.
Coaches had mutual respect.
Yeah.
And that's great.
Usually.
And Stephenville Decatur had that mutual respect.
Well, and usually your non-district games, unless there's a rivalry, you have to play. Your non-district games are usually going to be with people you know, coaches you know, you've worked with before and stuff. And so I think it's a lot easier to decide that stuff in non-district than it is district, where every game matters and all that.
Boy, you're hot in my ear.
Well, thank you, buddy. You're kind of hot yourself.
I am.
Oh, is that better?
Yeah, that's okay. A little bit better. Thank you.
I don't know why everything went great for 2A. Everything went great for 3A.
And then you got to run the board instead of me.
Grant Goodwin's wheels completely came off. That's not a Coke sponsor in the video. That's him trying to get the mic arm.
Was that on video?
Yeah, well, I mean, you can see it. You can see there's a Coke bottle.
Well, I don't have the monitor in front of me. So
there's a reason for that, because you would get to it. Anyway, so what we're going to do is what we always do. We're going to review last week, 4A, and then we're going to preview this week, and you're going to get to hear from Coach X.
And we're gonna
Yeah, beat down and a half. Anyway, we'll do all that when we come back right here on Sideline to Sideline, the 4A edition on L4 Media.
Some sports, a helmet just isn't part of the equipment, like basketball or soccer. Hockey has a small type of helmet. They just don't protect you against all the directions of forces that come into play. You can get forces on top of your head, on the side, on the back, but under the chin, there's nothing to protect that except for a physiologically positioned jaw. Putting your jaw in its physiologic rest position brings the actual jawbone away from the skull so that when you receive that force from an impact, that force doesn't get translated through the joint into that cradle of the skull, injuring the brain.
Wow, that last ad read. Think you've had your jaw in a physiological jaw position a few times, have you not?
You know what? You know what, dude? No.
I'm just making an observation based on your life.
So you're a big music guy, and
I'm not a big music guy.
And we're playing the recently late great Charlie Robinson, and you can see it on computer. See, that's what I love about having this. You can see it on playback. Mm-hmm. You kind of nod to me like, hey, let me bring this in. I'm like, you know what? He's going to say something cool. He's going to talk.
If you could see that on playback. He's
going to talk about Bandera, and that's where Charlie Wright. He's going to talk about the honky-tonks. No.
Honky's Lounge in Bandera, Texas is one of the greatest places, and Charlie Robinson played there a lot.
Do you just
Charlie lived there?
Do you just not want our sponsors to be happy? Just
take this away from Charlie Robinson and just diminish his career?
Now I'm doing
it. And his life.
All right. All right, I should learn my lesson.
To come in here
next time,
talk about some music.
And my jaw, apparently.
Football. I'm just talking about your life choices. That's okay.
Let's just talk football.
We don't need to go public with it.
Let's just talk football. All right. Just for once.
Tell me about the jaw, though. Unhinge it like a snake.
As
when you met somebody from
what?
Grinder or something. I don't know.
What is wrong with you?
Swallowing an ostrich egg.
All right. Time to turn down the mic. That's a good show. Now, let's get into it. Let's start with reviewing.
Did you really turn me down?
No.
Hello?
You just heard yourself.
Oh, okay.
Wow.
Testing.
Unfortunately, y'all landed the first 3 and now 4 weeks as the last show. I promise you will not always be the last show. We'll change it up. But let's start 4A week 3. Brownwood 24, Burnett 10. But the bigger news is that Eichhall got hurt, left the game with a shoulder injury. We do not know anything other than that. For this game, though, Brandon Stacks came in. He had a hell of a game, 12 of 15 for 144 yards. Braden Stacks, excuse me. Great win, but this is a possibly season-altering situation. We'll have to keep up and see.
I don't know. What did you say Stacks went? 12 of 15 for what?
144? Yeah.
Yeah, Brownwood's 3-0. We don't know about the Eichhall injury.
Yeah.
We're just going to assume everything's fine. They beat a good Burnett team by 14 points.
Yeah.
Well, and I don't think anybody expected Brownwood to be 3-0 at this point.
I did.
No, you did not.
Yes, I did.
I've got it on record that you had them at 1-2. I do. Want me to go find it? It's in the truck, but I got it written down.
No, I mean, and you did too. Have them going 3-0. We both
did.
We both felt with Eichhall that this team.
But was the only Eichhall's the only returning starter on that offense.
9 on defense though, and defensively so far they have played great. They gave up 21 to Abilene Wiley, 7 to Marble Falls, and then 10 in this game. They've got Glen Rose next week. We'll see. They still got Conley and Stephenville. If Eichhall doesn't play, that's going to get ugly.
It's going to get
but the district
hairy.
Is still the district in a couple rounds. It's not like they're going to now crater to 3-7. Eichhall special. Don't get me wrong. But I think the Lions are built to at least be able to withstand that and make the playoffs. After that, we'll just have to see. Hopefully, he'll be back. All right, Stephenville 56, Decatur 55.
Stephenville was down twice by 21 points.
Yes.
Twice.
Yes.
At one time. And then lightning delay. And then that resumed about 11:45. This game ended at 1:15 a.m.
It's just really hard to know what side of the delay is the real side, or maybe both of them are, but I don't know.
I don't either, but you got to take it for what it is. Just the full game. Just talk about the full game. I don't, who did it?
The
benefit, who did it?
Yeah, no, you're right about that. And so I
do know that Ryan Gafford went off at quarterback 408 yards. Tate Maruska ran for 134 yards. I don't know. I mean, it sounds like probably the delay help Stephenville.
Well, if
more,
you're down
maybe?
In the delay and you come back, and if you're down multiple scores and you come back after delay and win, it helps you. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm not taking that away from Stephenville. It's more for me.
Stephenville's done this in the past.
Oh yeah, they're come down from. Oh yeah, they're that team. They're one of those teams that has that Stephenville magic. But for me, it's more trying to calibrate Decatur because.
Right.
One thing about Decatur right now, they've played three great teams. You say that as a positive, but their defense has been terrible in three straight games. Yeah, it's against good teams.
And they're 0-3.
And they're 0-3. It's against good teams, but you're going to play these teams in the playoffs. So you've got to find that defense somewhere. They play Pampa this week. They get Alvarado in
they
2 weeks.
They play Pamper?
Pampa. Yeah, they play Pampers. Pampa. Yeah, they get one reprieve in this season, non-district. It's Pampa. I feel so sorry for the Harvesters in this game.
Yeah, I do too.
It's going to get ugly. But they've got Alvarado in a couple weeks.
Alvarado's one of the – they're kind of like Troop in 3A.
Yes.
Probably one of the most underrated teams out there right now.
And if Decatur can't stop them, and by the way, if you remember the old Jeff Dykus discus Alvarado, that's not them. They throw the ball and they throw it well. They score a lot of points quick. And if Decatur can't figure that defense out, they could end up easily being 1-4. They're not going to lose to Pampa.
It wasn't Dykus. It was from Southlake.
So it was Jeff Dykus.
No, it wasn't Dykus.
What quarterback?
Oh, never mind. Dykus was quarterback? I don't think.
I'm talking about the coach. The coach that Alvarado was there for 30 years.
Yeah, it wasn't Dykus, though.
I thought it was.
No, it was the guy from Southlake.
Anyway, we'll figure it out as we're talking. Where you want to go now?
All right. How about Wimberly, 35, Brock, 27. Wimberly's quarterback, Cody Stover, threw for 285 yards and three touchdowns. Noah Birdsong had 133 yards receiving. I was really impressed, though, by Wimberly's running game.
Yeah.
They didn't break big ones, but they just ground down a really good Brock run defense.
Jeff Dixon,
yes.
I knew the Jeff part was right.
You got the J and the D right. You did.
I know, but I saw that look. So you're going somewhere.
Looking down at the run sheet.
But yeah, you're right. You know, it wasn't that Wimberly went out and ran for 350 yards, but what they did, they jumped out early. Brock clawed back into it.
They extended drives.
Exactly. And just eight time off the clock. Because there was a point once Brock started making that comeback, it kind of felt like they were going to, if Wimberly doesn't do something, Brock can't be stopped at this moment. They had figured some things out offensively, but man, that Wimberly, and this is why this Wimberly team, again, they lose to Carthage 42-0 in the state championship game, and you kind of forget that's Carthage. This Wimberly team is better than last year's team at this point, and last year's team was the second best team in the division by a lot, and I think we're getting there again this year.
Yeah, look, again, just like last week, pins leaking all over me.
Looks
like I jacked off a squid.
Wow.
Graham, 35. Glen Rose, 21. Graham's quarterback, Ty Thompson, threw for 238 yards and three touchdowns. Is Ty Thompson not – I mean, look at his stats over the last 3 weeks. Is this not the best, at least statistically, the best quarterback in 4A right now?
That's a good question.
I know he's playing top five, top three, right? Ryan Mosley, running back, ran for 137 yards. Braden Riggins had 103 yards on just eight catches. So this Graham team, you know, they haven't played any big household names yet, right? So that I think that's maybe why they're not getting some of the respect.
Yeah, but
I think
this was a quality win.
I think it was a great win.
So on the year, he's thrown for 756 yards, eight touchdowns, zero interceptions. He is hitting passes at a 690 clip against Bowie. And I know it's Bowie, but still, this is impressive. A 91% completion percentage, 22 of 24 for 402 yards. Now, in the Springtown game, the Porcupines actually kind of gave him some issues. He was 15 of 27, but the most important thing, no interceptions. And that's we're in an era now where for quarterbacks, you've got to be aggressive yet not turn the ball over. This is every era we say the quarterback's the toughest position, but especially now, while people say, oh, well, they're protected and all that, they are. But if a quarterback doesn't go 22 of 30 for 300 yards and five touchdowns with no interceptions, people are like, well, those interceptions are killer. I mean, it's really tough to be a quarterback. And Thompson right now, you're right. I didn't realize the stats were that good.
Yeah, I mean, over 700 yards passing in just three games. Almost. I mean, the only other quarterback that I've seen that has thrown for more impressively is Collinsville in 2A. And he's thrown for 1,170 yards in three games. But
I was going to say, add on Thompson's 327 yards rushing, too. So he's already hit 1,000 total yards on the season.
That's
and he's got a lot more to go. P&G beat West Orange Stark 26-20. I only bring that up because we laugh about last year. When we watched that game, we were kind of...
You know, West Orange Stark was up a lot in this one. Not a lot, but most of the game.
Most of the game. But I laugh because last year we were so kind of down on West Orange Stark after the P&G game because they were like, man, P&G just kind of pushed them around. And West Orange Stark didn't look like they were interested. And then, of course, P&G ends up in the state championship game in 5A. So
P&G had a bunch of men up front.
And they have them back again. And this game, basically, other than West Orange Stark had the lead, in the second half, it looked a lot like last year. West Orange Stark just couldn't move the ball, but a lot of it was because P&G was just leaning on them.
Yeah. All right, how about Belleville 31, Navasota 3? Belleville got off to a slow start, put up just 3 points in the first half. Then they scored 28 points in the second half to pull away. This is kind of what Belleville's been doing lately, right?
Yeah, and like we talked about, though, you kind of feel like for them, they're just – I say going through the motions when they're winning like they are, but they're ready to get – they're still angry about getting knocked out in the second round last year.
Yeah, I think we maybe need to call Coach Rowe and see if we can come down there again and watch a game here pretty soon.
Yeah, you know, I thought at first it might be Brookshire Royal, but they've kind of – they're okay. They're 2-1, but they haven't been really impressive. And Iowa Colony beat the doors off of them last week.
Iowa Colony, though.
Yeah,
I mean, that's another
– that's a 5A school playing 4A. We'll be talking about them soon. Don't worry.
Yeah, we need to talk about them really quick because they might be a region favorite down there.
I really think they could be in a region that's just absolutely loaded with the Chapel Hills and all that. I think at the bottom of that, I think Iowa Colony could be the one that surprises everybody.
All right, Gilmer 43, Paris 40. Gilmer fell behind by a couple of touchdowns in the first half, and they had like 8 penalties in that first half. The game was kind of cold. I think it was called with like 6:07 left in the game due to lightning. So this is kind of one of those weird ones. But Gilmer did, to Gilmer's credit, come storming back. You know?
I'm confused. I will totally admit that I am confused about Gilmer, a team that couldn't stop Chapel Hill to save their lives, then put up a valiant fight defensively against the Kilgore team that's really, really good, held them to 24 points, and then they give up 40 to a Paris team that got beat by Salina 40-9 and beat Liberty Isle 30-0, but I think Liberty Isle is showing to be a little bit down than we thought.
You know, I watched that Paris Salina game.
Yeah.
And Paris is a lot better than I thought. Paris
is spreading the ball out this year. They're not running their old wing T. This is the first time in 15 years. And so there's growing pains. But they run
the ball really effectively.
Oh, yeah.
And I watched this game was online. And, it, you know, I watched the whole game against Salina for Paris. But it's still not the same being in person. But
no.
You can still see that Paris has some dudes.
Oh, yeah. They always do. I mean, for them, it's just being consistent. They've got some
dudes. So, you know, I take it for what it's worth. I thought Gilmer, though, would beat Paris by more.
Yeah.
Even though it was called with, 6:07 left in the game.
And that gives them plenty. That game could have gone either way.
Maybe there's a question with Gilmer defensively right now.
I mean, and maybe they just – what Kilgore does, Gilmer happens to do well, and that's stop the run. You know, Chapel Hill made their – I mean, they ran the ball times, but they made their hay throwing. And Paris, you know, like I said, they switched over.
Yeah.
And they're trying to throw the ball. Let's see. Cal Allen beat Flower Bluff 28-10. Only really bring that up because Flower Bluff beat Bernie.
I know. And Cal Allen, but a lot of people kind of wrote them off.
Oh, I still wrote them off. As far as a region threat, I mean, they're going to be a 2-3 round team. I'm not saying that they're bad by any stretch. I still think Flower Bluff, that game was first game of the year, played in 175 degree heat. I think Bernie got leaned on with depth. And I think if you play, and I even said that week one, if Bernie and Flower Bluff play like now, I think Bernie with the temperatures and playing more players. But yeah, it's still a good win for Cal Island.
Yeah, I don't discount this win.
No, I don't discount. No, not at all.
I think they're a little bit better than what maybe we thought. All right, how's this for a statement win? Sealsby does it again, beats Nederland 49-0, the shutout.
Yeah, I mean,
that's a statement win right there, my friend. Look, Nederland's not the best 5A team, but they're not all that bad.
Oh,
and
no.
Sealsby to come out and pitch a shutout and put up basically half a hundred on Nederland, that's a statement win right there.
Yeah, I mean, this is a matchup that usually – through the years when they've played, and they don't play every year, but when they've played, Silsby's been more of a thorn in the side of Nederland. This game was...
This is a special Silsby team, though. Yeah. I've watched them twice online and have been impressed with both of those. As a matter of fact, I would love to either go see Silsby Jasper or Silsby Hampshire Finette game. One of the two.
Yeah, both of those are two of the last 3 weeks of the season. So that West Orange,
one of those, though,
that West Orange Stark one game, West Orange Stark game, still looming large.
Oh,
too.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they played three hellacious games in district.
Yep. What are your thoughts on Cuero beating Yoakum only 41-34? You tried to warn people on the 3A and the 4A show last year. Last week you explained it so well that A, Yoakum is really good this year, but B, in this game, the lesser team. And I mean lesser just in this game, it tends to come up and bite the better team. And Yoakum bit, and Cuero finally got the lead and was able to hold them off.
Yeah, Yoakum had a 14-point lead over Cuero, if I understand it correctly. But I think Yoakum is a lot better than what people realize.
Oh, yeah.
And I think this takes nothing away from Cuero. Cuero still won the game. Cuero's still a region threat, but it's kind of like Texas OU. You can throw the records out the door. Each team is going to play each other to the death.
Yeah,
I mean, how big of a rivalry it is. All right, Pleasant Grove 45, Midland Christian 46. I watched this one online on and off. I fell asleep three or four times because I drove back from Hooks, Texas, for our game. I don't know, at 1 a.m. didn't get home till like 4. I had to stop for like 5 snacks. So I did not get home till late. So I kept falling asleep. I know Midland Christian was pushing Pleasant Grove while I was awake.
Yeah.
But Pleasant Grove, Jalen Bordley had a huge game. I can't remember exactly his stats, but Midland Christian had a tough time stopping him. But Midland Christian, in the first quarter and a half while I was awake, was moving the ball against this Pleasant Grove defense, which is pretty darn good. But I think Pleasant Grove is going to be fine after this one.
Yeah, the Hawks led at half 34-7. Spencer Danner, 16 carries, 156 yards. As you talk about the offense for them, almost 500 yards of offense. And I want to go back. I know this is a 4A show, but this reminds me just again how good that Brock defense is for holding this team
to
10 points.
Right.
Van, just a little shout out. Van, after getting thumped by Chapel Hill, they kind of, I don't want to call it a pure upset because I think Van and Lindell are a lot closer than people realize, but I think a good win for them. And we'll get to see a little bit more about Paris.
What was it? 42-37,
okay. A typical Van Lindell game.
Yeah.
And we'll get to see Paris and Van this week. So that's a good little calibration game when we're talking about what Paris did to Gilmer and it being 43-30. And then Van, who's in that region and would love to be a region dark horse, but you've got.
I got Van in a close one, by the way. I don't think that's on the run sheet for the next game.
But yeah.
I got a Van in a close one if you're asking me.
Okay. So you got Van in a close one.
Yeah.
All right. I got Van too as well.
Okay.
But I am curious that, again, people can't be understated. Paris is a team that ran the wing T forever. They've now spread it out. They're still doing wing T concepts on run because you can do that in a spread, but they're trying to work the ball down the field more, and it might just be taking them some time. We'll see if that Gilmer game was just a hiccup for the defense. Are you going to be okay, buddy?
Look how this pen.
I can't even see anything.
You can't see all that ink.
No. You said this last week. Maybe you're playing with an event. A squid with invisible ink, buddy.
All right, Salina 38, Prosper Walnut Grove 35.
Yes.
Surprising.
Well, I was told, I don't know how true this is, I was told that Walnut Grove had some players out for some issues that were not football related.
Before the Salina game, you mean? Or
yeah, for Salina, for this past week.
Really?
Yes. Yeah, so I don't know how true that is. So we'll see if that, because, you know.
I was pretty impressed.
I'm sorry for the Gunner game. That's what I meant.
That's what I'm saying.
I get what you're saying. Yes, for the Gunner game. And so maybe we didn't see the true.
Gunner blew him out, but Salina struggled.
Gunner blew him out, but Walnut Grove had like 400 yards of offense, including 250 in the first half against Gunner or something like that. It was a lot. So they moved the ball. They just couldn't score.
Yeah.
But for Salina, man, we've talked about it. This is just getting ready for district. This is a team as they're figuring out that offensive line, and they're two running backs that are a junior and a sophomore.
Really good.
Really good. A little bit of getting the snaps and experience in key positions. Don't count out Salina. They'll get lost in the discussion, but don't count out Salina this year. All right. Is that it?
Yep. All right. I think that's it for the review.
That's the review section. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to preview week four. Also have Coach X right here on Sideline to Sideline, the 4A edition. On S2S Sports, part of L4 Media. Talk high school football, 4A, 3A, and 2A in Texas. We talk East Texas sports. We talk NFL, guy talk, movie, and booze. We also talk wrestling and so much more. So like and subscribe and check us out.
Come back. But tonight, don't call it a comeback.
Terry Bennett Grant Goodwin back here. Sideline to Sideline, the 4A edition, brought to you by SI Design and Printing. Also brought to you by Small Town Society. You saw the image there. I had an ad. I had it all built out and everything. And I put the video together. And then when I went to play it for the 3A show, we had some issues. So I'm just going to give them this. Check out shopsmalltownsociety.com online, where you can see some great outfits. They also, we've been talking about their women's attire. They have Franklin football. That's where they support. They're also title sponsor of the Franklin football show. But they also have guys gear. They asked us, you know, if we'd like some stuff, and they're going to send us some stuff. We're going to put one of them on the wall, and then I'll make you wear the other one and, you know, walk in the streets going, shame, 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 because that's kind of where you're at tonight.
I'll ride for the brand.
You ride for the brand. I do appreciate that. Yeah, again, you can find them online at shopsmalltownsociety.com. You can find them on Facebook. Just type in Small Town Society. Email them hello@shopsmalltownsociety.com. They have everything. Like I said, they have the Franklin football gear. They have regular game day gear. They have game day men and boys. They have holiday. They have inspirational. Don't say anything. They have preach. Don't say anything. They have it all. If you're a Texas woman and you love to show your small town pride, you love to show your state pride, you love to show your spiritual pride, they'll take care of you there. And we do appreciate them being a sponsor. And we'll get the ad fixed for next week. Now,
aren't you proud of me? I didn't say anything.
I'd have muted you as soon as you did. Let's go to.
I almost sneezed because I was trying not to sneeze. I'm proud of myself for not sneezing.
Yeah, and all jokes aside, thank you. You're under the weather, and you still came in to get me sick and probably bring the show down, and we'll be out for the rest of the year. But great for showing up there, buddy.
I've been going on having this stuff since Canadian 2 weeks ago.
I mentioned
I felt better, and now I feel worse.
Well,
in the hell?
I mentioned to my dad. He always asks how the show's going. I said, doing well. You're under the weather. You've had it for a couple weeks, and he's like, yeah, welcome to your 50s. That's you're just basically sick the rest of the way.
I think I got it from the hotel in Canadian.
I like that place. I don't think you liked it.
No, I mean, it was mostly just the scorpions, the bed bugs, the mold.
There was no bed bugs or mold.
I got a rash everywhere. I think.
Well, that's because you haven't taken your daily that you've been taking for 20 years for other things.
I don't know. I think it was from Canadian.
Dude, he slept like a baby.
or the Easy Mart in Redwater.
I will go with that. I told you, don't get the hot dogs at Redwater. All right, Coach.
Didn't eat a hot dog in Redwater.
Speaking of, Redwater's the one place that wouldn't even hire Coach X. Let's see what Coach X has to say. So it seems like the show's been going swimmingly so far this year, and I think we all know why. I think it's because of the big news that happened this summer. We all know what that was. The man, Elon Musk, changed the Twitter logo to the X. We all know that the X is going to give it to you. See, if I was a WWE superstar now, I would say hit my music. So, Elon, if you're listening, and we all know you are, I appreciate the fanfare. And sorry those hippies made you take my name off your building. Move that building to X. Us, and we will party like it's 1999. And if you were there at that New Year's party, that was at that night. It was a hell of a night. On with the picks. We all know for 1999, Coach X, all he did was drink schnapps and play Tekken. He didn't do anything else.
And Goldschlager.
The schnapp was, you know, he was a Goldschlager guy. Like, he probably still has gold chunks in his mouth.
Do you think he thinks that Elon Musk actually listens because he had Lyle Lovett?
I will say this, Elon Musk is the type that if he knows that Lyle Lovett would be listening, he would be curious. I'll give Elon Musk credit for that. That dude will respond to so many different people on Twitter, people that have two followers. So let's just let him think.
Okay.
I hate to tell him that's probably Lyle Lovett's PR guy just being like, who's this dumb asshole? Let me like him. Got to make sure Lyle looks good in front of the
media. That's the whole thing about Twitter. It's them.
Who's them?
You know, these celebrities.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we're celebrities on Twitter.
So, well, no, we're not. But Justin Timberlake.
I mean, we have stars that follow us.
Who?
Juliet Landau follows us.
Who?
Juliet Landau, the daughter of Martin Landau, the famous actor.
I know Martin Landau.
Yeah, his daughter, who was on Buffy, follows us. I'm not kidding. You can go look on our thing. Juliet Landau.
So who's Buffy?
Okay, anyway, let's get into the show before we go down.
Just asking.
Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I like horror. I like Buffy the Vampire Slayer TV
show. I like horse too, but... I don't.
That's why you got the rash.
For a whore in Redwater?
Or Canadian, apparently. I thought you went to sleep listening to Tulsa Cry. Maybe you
ain't Love a Call again.
Maybe you're walking over there by. Maybe you're walking over there by the.
Yeah, I had some Denny's shrimp and set out and watched the escorts.
300-pound woman in a body stocking. Anyway, let's get into 4A preview of the week 4 action. And we've got a weird matchup here. Alvarado versus Rusk. This is a game that legitimately could go into the 60s. Both of these teams like to score a lot. Alvarado, we talked a little bit about their 3-0 on the year. Cadre Collier, their quarterback, thrown for 529 yards. He's ran for 230. So we were talking about the Graham quarterback. He's not far off.
No, he's not. And he's got two really good receivers in Shamarian Lee and Logan Bort.
I love these type of matchups where it's two teams you wouldn't really think would ever play. You know, Rusk in Deep East Texas, Alvarado, you know, in the North Texas area. I think this game started because of a COVID a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. But either way, we need more of these type of games.
Do you think Alvarado might be vastly underrated?
I think both of these teams are vastly underrated.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I kind of thought Rusk, their heyday was the last 2 years. I didn't think if Russ didn't get it done two years ago and last year, they weren't going to do it. But here they are, only with one loss.
Yeah, and that their issue is going to be defense. And that's why I think this game could be a high-scoring game. They lost to Athens last week, 45-38. They have another McCown after Owen McCown left. Aiden McCown's now the quarterback. Of course, Thomas Sitton, the guy that was at Chapel Hill, he's been at Rusk now for 5 or 6 years, and he's really kind of, you know, Rusk, when we first started doing this show, you had the Cody Glenn who went to Nebraska. You had the guy after him that might have been even more talented, but he couldn't stay, you know, he kept getting in trouble. And then they kind of went into a free fall. And Coach Sitton came in a few years ago, and he's kind of slowly started.
One heck of a coaching staff.
And it helps when you have a McCown NFL player and all, and all. The McCown family's all in that area. You've got some of them at Jacksonville where they played. Mm-hmm. You've got some, I think you have one going to Brook Hill now. But I think this is a game that I have Alvarado winning, but they've got to go to Rusk in this game, and that's not an easy travel.
If Alvarado is the underrated team I think they are, mm-hmm. and they're as good as I think they are, they go in and they beat Rusk at home by 14 to 21 points.
Wow.
If that's what I want to see.
I have no problem there.
That's what I want to see out of the Indians. If they are that good, which I think they should might
go on
be,
the road and be able to take care of it.
Yes. In convincing fashion.
I don't disagree with you on that. I mean, because if you're going to –
saying they will. That's what I'm saying. If they are the team that I think they are. And I think they are.
Yeah.
So give me Alvarado by 14-21.
All right. They gave up 41 to Springtown, 7 to Kennedale, and then 3 to Lincoln. The Springtown was a little concerning, but again, first game of the year.
Yeah.
So we'll see. Daniel Dixon, by the way, we hope you're doing better in Springtown.
Us an update.
I haven't. The last time he said he was feeling better, that's
not you, Daniel.
Yeah, give us an update, Daniel. All right, Coach X says, before I make my picks, I'd like to point out that I'm undefeated this year in picks. Yes, I am. Check the tape. If you don't believe me, no, we get on that. Anywho, does Rusk ever play West Rusk? They should. But if they did, would they have been called East Rusk? East versus West, just like the Civil War. I've done some research on that war. Not so civil. I went to school who had a brother named Ricardo that sounds a lot like Alvarado, so I guess I'll pick East Rusk. That might be the most Coach X pick of all time right there. Yeah, that was pretty good. All right, let's go. Let's stay in East Texas. Marshall versus Carthage. Mm. This game's in Carthage.
A game dear to my heart.
Now, shut up. You and Coach X. Look, Carthage is going to win this game. They're going to win by 3 or 4 touchdowns.
Neither of us said that. You're just projecting.
No, I'm calling it like I see it. Okay. The last time
you don't think that Marshall defense can shut down Jet Surratt, KJ Edwards, KD Matlock, Braden Manning, a defense that's pretty much sophomores and juniors that is really good.
Yeah, so. I think Marshall's fine this year. I think this reminds me of when I went and saw them in 2018 and Marshall. And I'm not saying this team's going to go that far, but that team played Huntsville to a controversial 2-point conversion call, no call from winning the region. And Carthage went into Marshall and beat them comfortably. Marshall had a kickoff return at the beginning of the second half that kind of made it close and got them close, but you never were in doubt of who that game was going to win that game. I feel the same way about this one. I think Marshall's going to be fine this year. They're 1-2, but they lost to Tyler in overtime, and Tyler High has bounced back from where they were last year when they kind of collapsed. They're undefeated. They lost to Longview, who lost only to McKinney in a great game. And then they beat Henderson last week 35-20, but that wasn't a complete game. Henderson at times moved the ball, and Marshall turned over the ball, and those are all recipes when you go into Carthage to get beat 42-17.
So – I'm going to pick Carthage by 13-14 points.
Okay.
You think that's out of line? You know more about Marshall.
No, I think Carthage is 3-4 touchdowns better than Marshall. Okay. Easy.
Okay.
I do think maybe some depth. I mean, you're talking about a Carthage program that at 4A Division II has Carthage the roster of 5A Division II. That's what Marshall. I'm saying.
Yeah.
I mean, this isn't your normal – leap across one full classification.
No, absolutely.
And Marshall has a good size roster for a 5A Division II school, but Carthage is special. It's just like Salina back in 2A. You look on their sideline and they look like a 4A school.
Yeah.
That's where Carthage is now. And it's Jack Alvarez. If he stays at Marshall for the long run, he's going to do great things. And he's already started because Marshall last year probably shouldn't have been 6-5. They're in a talent vacuum. And they're getting out of that, and they've got some good quarterback. I like their quarterback, Collier Sloan. They've got a fast defense. I just think Carthage is better.
Yeah.
All right, let's see what Coach X has to say. This is a tough game here. Well, not the game itself. Carthage is going to win. But just coming up with something to say about a school that has produced so many football players like Marshall. Why a Tittle? That other guy that could run fast. And who could forget the other guy who could run fast? That is what Marshall's kind of known for. Then there's a guy that went on to start a podcast with Grant. He didn't really run fast, though, like the other two guys. But way to go, Grant. You do a great job, and you let Larry talk, so the big guy upstairs is going to remember that. Go Dogs.
You're welcome, man. You're welcome.
Are y'all saying I'm like a make-a-wish? All this is just to make
universe.
Me feel special?
Yeah, pretty much.
For 16 years? Look,
go easy on Terrence and just make him feel a little bit better. Maybe he'll get into the Marshall Athletics Hall of Fame like Terrence, I did where I went to school.
Not why did yet. You get into the Marshall Hall of Fame?
I didn't. No. I didn't get into my own Hall of Fame yet.
Your sister did.
Thanks, dude. Thanks a lot.
Isn't that a good thing? I mean, congratulations. Was that 3 years ago?
Yeah, thanks, Jennifer. I'm proud of her.
Yeah, I can see the pride right now.
Jasper versus Franklin. Jasper's quarterback, Isaiah Coleman, has been great, but Zakeelan had not, and Peyton Brooks at running back have been absolute beast on the offensive side of the ball. But Ty Anthony Smith, the linebacker for Jasper, one of the best in the state. And look, They're going up against one of the best running backs in the state, Jaden Jackson at Franklin. But I think Jasper will win this game. I think it's going to be a close one, but this is going to be an all-out war. But give me Jasper to get the revenge from last year. You know, Franklin kind of put it on Jasper last year, right?
Yeah, well, it was 41-35, but if I remember, Jasper scored like two late touchdowns to kind of make it closer. I just, you know, you and I talked about this. If Franklin wins this game,
I'd be a little bit shocked.
I'm not going to say shocked, but it would. I mean, already Franklin's a favorite, but that would just make me go, okay, Franklin might not be untouchable. I mean, might be untouchable this year. I think Jasper's strength is exactly the thing that Franklin does well. And I think when we kind of joked in the 3A about linebackers not wanting to stick their hat in against Franklin, you have a Jasper defense that thrives on the hitting as well. there's going to be no tapping out. It's just the clock's going to run out.
Right.
I've got Jasper winning like a 27-24, 27-21 type game, which oddly enough, that sounds like a high scoring game with what these two defenses can do.
Right. But low scoring and they all,
oh, let me see
things what, given in the state of football.
Yeah, we're state in, of right? football now. Exactly. Yeah. Let's see what Coach X has to say. Physical game here. Franklin will punch you in the mouth and make you like it. Hey, why is that a saying? Why is that a saying? Has anybody ever been punched in the mouth and said, that was great, I like it? You know what? I bet Grant has. Probably seen some movies like that with leading ladies that get stuff put in there. Well, I think you see where I'm going with that.
It's Lions a snuff film, sir.
Lions versus Bulldogs. Got to go with the Green Lions and say one like 30 something. Yeah, they've won 35.
Or... Seen that movie, 35 millimeter or
whatever. 8 millimeter.
8 millimeter. No, that's 8 mile.
No, it's 8 millimeter.
Get 30, in music.
35.
What?
That's just. I just love
the we're talking millimeters.
I just love you threw out a random camera size that you didn't know. Yes, I've seen 8 millimeter. It's really good.
Have you seen Kodachrome?
No, I haven't.
Cool.
Where you want to go?
That was with Ed Harris, Jason Sudeikis, and some girl with weird eyes. It's cute though.
Your mom, your fiance.
Hey, made whoa! My mom just broke her arm. You can't.
That was 3 weeks ago. You can't keep riding on
still
that.
Hurting.
You can't keep. I was trying to say, did Kelly make you watch it? Your fiance made you watch Kodachrome, didn't you?
No,
you did not.
We watched like manly stuff, like Married at First Sight and Below Deck.
Tulsa 911. All you watch when we go
Tacoma 911. I don't watch stupid stuff.
All you watch when we're on the road now is true crime stuff. Can I fall asleep for true crime? Is it okay, man? Would it bother you?
This first 48.
It's Tulsa.
Yes, exactly. Murder in Tulsa. I never want to go through Tulsa again because every first 48. And what was the comedian's like? Every first 48. It's like cartoon characters.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Dookie shoes. I saw Dookie shoes talking to Muppet, and Muppet said, no, Dookie shoes didn't do it. That was funny to me.
Where are you at? Where are we going now?
Belleville versus Cameron. Yo, Belleville's running back, San Renicki, is back, man. He's already ran for 406 yards in, what, 3 games this season? Two other running backs, Corey and Hood and DeeDee Murray, have combined for almost 700 yards rushing. They're playing a Cameron team, though, offensively, though, with running back Kadarius Bradley, receiver Braylon Drake, and Carson Goolsbee that can move the football. I think Cameron's defense is kind of expose them a little bit, but offensively they're going to be able to move the ball against Belleville, but I don't think enough. They can't keep up with Belleville. Belleville's going to wear them down with that three-headed monster, man, running the football. Belleville's just a machine.
You know, we said
I think they're pissed off from losing in bi-district last year.
Second round.
I think Belleville, the Brahmas, are a little pissed off, and they're going to take it out on a lot of people.
You know, we had talked before about a few years ago when this said same Cameron Yeo team just took Dieball to the woodshed, and we saw Dieball kind of flinch, and we said, well, Dieball's got to prove that they're physical again, and they eventually did. Cameron Yeo last year flinched in the game that we saw against Franklin, and until I see them stay in the gaps and their linebackers aren't bailing out as soon as the ball's
set. I don't think Cameron's defense wants any of these problems that Belleville's offense is going to give them.
And this is why I don't think their offense will score. I think Belleville will keep the ball away. I like this being a 42-7 type game for Belleville.
It could be. I could see that.
Let's see what Coach X has to say. The Yeoman versus the Bells. So there is a Bells and a Belleville. Are they related? like the two cousins start a town and they have a disagreement and say, I'm dropping that Ville off of our name and I'm going to be a Bells. No, you can't come with me. You're starting your own town and I refuse to live in a town where you can't stay up after midnight and let it all hang out. Because, you know, after midnight, we're going to chug along and shout. So for that reason, I'm going with the Omen because I know they love to chug a lug and shout. He is so technical with his picks. I love how he breaks down the three sheets.
Right.
About the first down flow and everything. Good job, Coach X.
All right. Some quick hitters right? All right. Dangerfield versus center. Who do you got?
Dangerfield in a shootout.
Me too. All right. I like this Dangerfield a little bit more. Look, center offenses outside of maybe Chapel Hill might be one of the best offenses in the state of Texas.
I don't
want to
play
right
in the first couple rounds.
Outside of Chapel Hill and Silsby.
Yeah.
Let me say that. Center might be one of the best offenses, but Dangerfield's defense is better, and Dangerfield can move the ball on anybody, so I like Dangerfield as well. All right, Newton and West Orange start. Give me West Orange start.
Give me Newton.
Oh, did you pick them in the three? Okay.
No, I didn't. Because I'm sorry. Give me West Orange start. My only reasoning, though, is Newton's played one game in 3 weeks. They've had two games canceled.
My reason is West Orange start's a lot better than people think, and West Orange start is better than Newton. All right. Conley at China Spring. Give me China Spring.
Give me China Spring, but it wouldn't shock me if the Cadets keep this within three touchdowns.
Within three touchdowns.
But I mean, they usually don't the last few years. Even their good teams have gotten kind of waylaid again. But I think this Conley with Kieber might be a little different, but I still, dude, China Spring. For all the talk of Carthage, China Spring is just Carthage part two. They're just a machine at this point. A 6'2", 300 pounder goes out, that's fine. They got a 6'1", 290 freshman. He'll just step right in and you'll forget about it. I like China Spring in this one.
All right, Cuero versus Cal Allen. I am going against conventional wisdom here, and I'm going Cal Allen with the upset.
Both teams have something to prove after last week. But you look at
Cuero's undefeated.
I know, but they struggled against Yoakum. And again, we're rivalry game, blah, blah, but they still struggled against Yoakum. Right. They were down two scores. This wasn't, they got up and held them off. They had to go past Yoakum, and they did. They beat Navarro 35-7. They beat Campo 41-7. I don't see where you're getting it. I think Cuero wins. I think Cuero wins by three touchdowns.
Conventional wisdom says, and if I were actually putting money on it, I would say Cuero. Now, I am going to go because there's no money on it, right? I'm going Cal Allen with the upset.
I have no problem with that. If Cal Allen wants to prove to me that they're better than what I think they are,
will prove that they're – win or lose, prove that they're better. I think this will be a game no matter what. I don't think it's a blowout, but I'm going to pick Cal Allen in the upset. All right, Lavernia versus Navarro. Give me Navarro in a close one.
Lavernia's defense has been playing pretty good this
Lavernia
year.
Lavernia is really good, and I'm actually kind of thinking about changing my pick.
Because I was about to go Lavernia, and you knew it. Yeah, you know, the Bears on the year, to give you some understanding, they've given up 27 to Burnett, 7 to Gonzalez, shut out LaGrange last week, 45-0.
Yeah, I'm going Navarro. I'm going Lavernia. I'm changing my pick.
Yeah, I just like what they, you know, last year they kind of quietly went 9-3.
This is going to be a hell of a game.
Oh, yeah, I think this is a good game. I think, you know, it's going to be it's the same rule every time you play Navarro. Can you keep their offense off the field? Not let them getting long sustained drives, and they tend to struggle early in the season because their offense, it kind of takes a while to get rolling downhill. And I think this is one of those games where the Bears are looking at this as, and every team in this region do, they look at that as a kind of a statement game, measuring themselves.
All right, the last one we have is Anna versus Salina. Give me Anna. One of the games that I've watched online, Anna is probably one of the most impressive teams in Class 4A that I've seen so far, outside of Carthage and China Spring. I think Anna, they don't name their score, but they're missing the Amherst kid.
Yeah.
But it does not matter. That quarterback that Anna has now, who's like a junior, I think, is a true dual threat. They've got athletes everywhere. Anna is better than they were last year. Salina can run the football on anybody, but I think this Anna team is special. Give me Anna by 8-14.
I like Salina in this game. I think you've got us. Anna's defense has played one good team and gave up 30 to Decatur. They shut out Aubrey. Aubrey's showing they're not what we didn't think they were going to be a lot, but they were really good last year. We thought they might be. This game is in Salina, and this just feels like one of those games where that Salina running game goes for 45 carries and 280 yards.
Maybe, but I'm going to tell you, but either way, it's a great game offensively.
Oh, yeah, they do. And if Salina gets into a shootout with them, they're going
to
lose.
Nobody wants to get in a shootout against Anna.
But the problem is can you stop Anna? So you might have to. I'm just calling this a slight upset. Also, this is like the last test for Anna until the playoffs. Well, maybe Paris, but in Coffin, but I don't really think they're going to be tested. Coffin's surprisingly 0-3. But I think Salina wins this game. But either way, we're going to think the same about these two teams coming out of it. All right. I think that's it, brother.
Yeah.
Great week four show. We do appreciate everybody for joining us. Again, you can find us on YouTube at L4 Media Company. You can also, when you go to our podcast site, S2S Grant and Terry, .com. You can, if you type into this or hit this episode, we embed the YouTube. So even if you're just been normally doing audio, check out the YouTube. Our executive producer and director, Taylor Lee, he tries to get these out by Wednesday night at the latest, sometimes into Thursday. But you can always find the audio. They'll be up by Wednesday morning. We post them on all of our social media sites, Sideline to Sideline on Facebook, at Grant and Terry on Twitter. Email us, Grant and Terry at S2Sport.com. Until then, he's Grant Goodwin. I'm Terry Bennett. This has been Sideline to Sideline, the 4A edition, brought to you by SI Design and Printing on L4 Media.